So there is another piece of innovation that I forgot to mention, is that I will try, probably will not manage all the times, but I will try to post the script before the lecture, okay? So that you can print it down or whatever, and instead of being there, right, what's this letter, I don't understand, blah, blah, blah. You have it in front of you, and you can just write the notes, because it's better if you concentrate on what I say than on what I write, okay? I hope this is of some help. Good, let's continue with our beloved tensors. And of course, whenever we have objects such as numbers, vectors, and so on, there are operations in between them, sums, multiplications, scalar product, blah, blah, blah. The same we are going to have in the same fashion and even more for tensors. Operation with tensors, S, plural, operations, more than one. We have a simple one, which is the sum. They are linear mappings, and if we take two tensors, let's say T and V as tensors, they are going to give us another tensor that I call S. Simple linear mapping. Can have a matrix representation, you can sum them up. And you get a new tensor that has the same rank and type of the other two. T I j plus V I j is equal to S I j. And of course, if there is the plus, there is also the subtraction. But instead of the plus, you put the minus. Then you have the multiplication with a scalar. Scalar. That if you have a tensor, you can multiply it with some scalar number, and you get a new tensor that has exactly the same rank, with alpha belonging to R. And the components are going to be T I j is equal to S I j. So the S I j components are just the one of T multiplied by the scalar function. Then we have the outer product that we have seen, but I would like to show it again because you can also use it to generate tensors by using, for example, one forms that are not the basis. Outer product that we have defined before, we created it, so it's a definition, and can be given not only by the basis, but by one forms, Q and P. If we are dealing with a tensor with the two indexes below, okay? And again, you understand that you have the generalization, you can have all the possible mixture you might desire. And this tensor, constructed in this way, so you can use also different one forms to create new vectors, as you have vectors that can be created by vectors, you don't only need the basis, because you can also express them as linear combination of any linear independent vector, right? This is the same, very same concept. And this object can be applied, in this case, since it's applied to one forms, is applied to vectors. I used U. Okay? And we have seen that this object is defined as the first object applied, the first one form applied to the vector V, time the other one form applied to the vector U. This was the definition that we give for this operation. So it's just a way of writing, okay? The outer product, the machinery is this one. This is a way of writing, okay? Good. So yes, so in this case, we are getting two vectors that are belonging to the vector space. And we have two one forms that are Q and P that belong to the dual. And we created this, this new tensor with this outer product. Okay? You see the outer product is quite powerful if you want to create new tensors. Another example with the outer product is that you might have this scenario. And you can have as many as you like, according to what you are doing. In this case, is not a bilinear map like this one, swallowing two vectors, but is, of course, swallowing three vectors. One, two, three, one, two, three. And definition of our beloved one form, so we have Q, sorry, of the outer product, we have Q applied to V, we have P applied to U, not to U, to U vector, and then R applied to S. And look what, these are just products, and this guy is a tensor. So it's a tensor, T, let's call it small t, which is applied to T and U. What does it mean? It means that we can basically apply a tensor, V, U, to R tilde and S in this way. Therefore, this kind of defines a new outer product, you see, between a tensor and a one form. So you don't have only one forms, but you might have as well tensors and one form. And in this case, again, this is the way of writing in the style of the outer product. We have the tensor that I call it a small t, sorry, that's a small t. Then it's a small t, t outer product of R, one form, which is applied to V, U, and S. Okay? Then we have the inner product, inner product in which we might have, for instance, I'm giving you examples here all the time, a tensor which is called T. Maybe it's swallowing one form, so it has one with the index up, and it's swallowing vectors, one with the index down. And it's applied to a tensor, applied to the basis E. So we have E and E repeated twice. So what is that? Well, let's use this guy here. We see that these are the components, EJ, E up, J down, and then we have the component of S, which is S with E down. And now look, you see that we have a repetition of indexes. What does it mean? That they are dummy variables now. This is a summatory over the E indices, which give us a new tensor that have only that has only one index, J. Okay? So the core is this repetition of indices. If we had a vector and one form, one index up, one index down, dummy variable, the two indices disappear and we get a scalar, right? This is exactly the same concept, but generalized for these objects with a higher rank. Take care that if you flip the two, it's not commutative. This is not a commutative operation in general. Okay, so if you flip the two, you get a different tensor. So take care of that. Good. Then we have contraction. Which is very important, as we are going to discover. And again, let's take an example. Let's take a rank 3 tensor that is swallowing 3 objects. And let's say that this tensor is of type 1, 2, with alpha, beta, and gamma. So it's swallowing one form, and it's swallowing 2 vectors. Because the vectors has an index up, so the swallowing is kind of diagonal, if you want to think in it this way. Good, so let's see. What we can do? Well, we can define out of this tensor, we can define an object with a lower rank. And we can just do that by applying one basis. Alpha. Then this one, we leave it free. And then we have a vector, and therefore it's an E, and is the gamma index. There is not an equal here. Huh? And what is giving us? You see, these are fixed. We keep it fixed. We are left with one free slot. This gives us a rank 1 tensor. So we go from rank 3 to rank 1. So we have a tensor. We let it swallow 2. Vectors, one slot is free. This operation gives you one tensor with a lower rank. So this is lowering the rank. It's not rising or lowering indices, it's lowering the rank. It's lowering the total number of indices in your tensor. How is this associated? This operation can be associated to the metric by involving the metric acting on the object, and to see that, we get our vector S that has an index B, which is, as we have seen, defined as T. We construct it as omega tilde alpha. Then we must have a vector beta, and then we must have the vector basis, what was it, gamma. Gamma, okay? So this guy, together, is S with index beta. And this is the component beta of our tensor because I applied to it the beta component. So if I want to write it in a different way, I can write it as well like this. Okay? Okay, good. And if I now look at the entire object here, here I'm not doing anything, so alpha. The indices are repeated. Otherwise, the game is not taking place. Okay, so alpha and alpha. It's kind of swallowing itself, but the self-swallowing happens through the metric, because this is, if we take this guy here, you see that this is T alpha, beta, and alpha. Right? Tensor applied to the 3 bases, index alpha, 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 and here we have beta, beta, and beta. How is this associated to the metric? Well, through the lowering of the index. Because I can write this guy as G alpha and let's take nu P nu beta alpha. And again, we have our repeated index here and here. That's the contraction. So from a rank, from this tensor, we are arriving with a tensor with a lower rank. And this happens because there are repeated indexes up and down, if you want to read it this way. And this operation actually means to get the tensor and apply to the metric in this way. Last operation, we have derivatives. So we can apply a derivative to tensors. And what we basically have is just our derivative with respect to the alpha component of a tensor. Again, an example, T mu nu could be whatever indices you want. This gives us a new tensor that is alpha mu nu. Once you have a derivative applied to a tensor, you get a tensor with a higher rank. Every time you apply a tensor, we started with a tensor which was 2, 0, two indices up, nothing below. We apply the derivative, and we end up with a tensor 2, 1. So we go from rank 2 to rank 3. We are hiring the order, the rank, sorry, of the tensor. Oh, another board here. Then what we can do is to map tensor on vectors. What does it mean? That we can have a tensor T. Again, I take an example with three slots that I leave free, but I fill it up with one vector. So we have a vector that belongs to V and is fixed, okay? What do you think we get? A tensor of lower order, because we have only two slots free. Therefore, we have that this guy, oh, should have left a bit more space, is equal to a tensor with two free slots, which is rank 2. So we go from rank 3 to rank 2. What are the components of these tensors, of these S tensors? S alpha beta are equal to what? Well, we have, if it's swallowing other two vector, other two one forms, for instance, then we are going to plug here the basis, E alpha, E beta, and then there is, that's it, right? If we now use the construction, it means that this T, this S alpha, this S applied to these two bases is this guy. Therefore, this is equal to E alpha, E beta, and then we have our vector. Which reads what? It reads T alpha, beta, and gamma, that I didn't use, V gamma. Operating this way, we have a linear map that is sending a vector to another tensor, which in this case is v cross, v cross v tilde tilde. Then last thing for today. I just want to mention two special tensors. One is the metric that I'm not going to repeat here, okay? Because we already know a little bit how it works. One is the Levi-Civita symbol, or the Levi-Civita tensor. Which is a tensor, usually called epsilon, which can have a different number of indices. Let's say our four-dimensional space. I use the alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. And this guy is equal to plus 1, minus 1, or 0. And you have plus 1 if you have even permutations of, in this case, we have four indices, so in this we have four permutations, in this case, of 0, 1, 2, 3 as indices. And minus 1 if you have odd permutations of these four numbers, and 0 otherwise. Okay, try the cases in which you make the permutations, for example, of double indices. Better than otherwise, for example, you have double repeated indices. It means that you have done the permutation twice, and it has to be equal to itself. And again, the same number that is equal to itself, which is both positive and negative, is the 0 that gives you that. So you start with this one, and then you start to make the permutations, and the Levi-Civita symbol is constructed in this way. Give you a few examples. For example, we have the epsilon 0, 1, 2, 3. That's the starting point. That's equal to 1. Then let's make the permutation between two numbers. 0, let's flip 2 and 1. 2 and 1, 3, for example. And this is going to be equal to minus 1. Then we have epsilon, let's take any index, nu, 1, 2, 0, for example. Let's cut it short, let's do like this. With these two repeated indices, this is equal to 0, because we made one permutation, would give us a minus value. We flip it, which means we're doing nothing. We should give us a plus 1, so a plus value, but the only number that is equal to itself when it's multiplied by time 1 and 0, time 1 and minus 1, is the 0. And then you can find all the rest. Then you need to play a little bit with that, and I let you, there is an exercise about that that you're going to play with. Okay, this guy is quite useful, because, for example, you have the cross product. Let's take the magnetic field, okay? This cross product, which is written this way in a frameless representation. When we introduce a frame, we are going to have A, J, K, and then D, J, B, K. Okay? If I want to write the components to make it clear, component E. Component E, which is free, and then we have JK, JK that is repeated. And you know that the cross product is this linear combination of derivatives and production and products with the magnetic field. Okay? So this is very convenient. And this guy, is invariant under Lorentz transformations. Not in general, not for any transformation. Last important tensor is the delta Kronecker, which is that you already know. Which is often written as delta with ij as two indices. And this guy is equal to 1 if e is equal to j, and 0 if e is different with respect to j. And what it basically does is to swap the index of a vector. So if you have the Levi-Civitas, the Kronecker delta apply to a vector, you get the vector itself. So it plays the role of the identity. And is always the same in all frames. Okay, this guy is always the same. And if you apply it, if you now use the component ij, applied the vector j, you get the component e. You see? Given a vector, it selects one component, which is not the one that you give it to it. Okay? So it selects the component, but it's not changed. You see? It's still the VE is the same of the vector. It's not multiplied, subtracted, or whatever. Okay? So if you wish, you can see it as the identity, which is not a real way of phrasing it, but you see that it's not changing vectors. What it's just doing is selecting components. And for today, that's it. So I can give you back 10 minutes of life that I was stealing in the previous lectures. And just give me 5 minutes, otherwise steal too much, 2 minutes to go through the summary. So we now, before we constructed the tensors, we know what they look like. We find out that we can sum them. We can apply scalar product to them. We define the outer product that allows you to create the tensors out of combination of one forms or of vectors or mixture of vectors and one forms. We define the inner product between tensors, where you have this repetition of indices, and when you have the two tensors, you get lower rank object. We have the contraction that you see is given by a repetition of the indices twice, here and here, or if you wish, is coming out by the application of the tensor to the metric. Okay? And again, when there is the application of the metric tensor to a generic tensor, the indices are repeated here. Okay? Then we have seen that there are derivatives, and this expression holds only for flat geometry. Okay? Only for flat geometry. We are going to compute derivative for tensors on a curved space, and you will see that the derivative will look very different. Okay? That's because when you move on the manifold, the bases are changing. They're not always the same across the manifold. Then we map tensors onto vectors. And in the end, I just gave you the definition of the Levi-Civita symbol or tensor. It's called symbols many times because in a flat space it's not changing, so it's kind of just something static that is not a collection of numbers, as a collection of numbers. And the Kronecker delta, that is this operator that, if you wish, kind of select the index, one of the components out of a vector. Next time we will start with manifolds. Therefore, we are going to investigate the manifolds in general. We are going to define the tangent space, which is the space in which vectors are living in each position over the manifolds. And afterward, we are going to introduce the derivative, the covariant derivatives, that allow us to connect different locations of vectors on the manifold. Okay? And then after this, we will get out of the curvature. And out of the curvature, then we will get the Einstein's fields equations that describe gravity. OK? So next time, curved spaces. Thank you, and see you.